Hi everyone. So I'm Tarini Ross. I'm Program Manager at Humanitarian Aid International in India and also the Charter for Change Secretariat Coordinator. So I'm here to talk to you about the Charter for Change and how we've been using D groups for our work. So the Charter for Change, some of you may know, may have heard about it, but the Charter for Change is a global network. It's an initiative led by local, national, and international NGOs who have come together to practically implement changes in the way we work within the humanitarian architecture. So the Charter for Change, it includes 8 commitments based on localization, which INGOs have signed on to. So at present, we have 38 Charter for Change signatories, so INGOs who have signed the charter and have committed to making progress. On the other hand, we have 440 plus endorser members who are local and national NGOs who have joined to support their INGO partners in making change and holding them accountable to the commitments we've signed. The Charter for Change, just to give you a bit of background, it was introduced in 2015 and officially launched in 2016 by a handful of organizations. Now we've grown to have this very diverse membership of endorsers and signatories from over 56 countries. The Charter for Change network was earlier being hosted by CAFFORD in London, but because the agenda of the network is to have more locally led response and to make changes, to have local actors really lead in every phase of response, we've shifted the Charter for Change secretariat to a local organization. So at present, Humanitarian Aid International, which is the local NGO in India, we are currently hosting it till end of 2021. Thereafter, we'll shift again to another local organization. So we use the D Groups platform for in terms of the technology, we use the D Group platform to do all our online work. So all our online groups are based on the platform, and we have 2 main groups. One of the international INGOs who have signed, the signatory members, where all of them are in the C4C signatories D group. And on the other hand, we have all our local and national NGO members who are in the C4C endorsers D group. Other than these 2 main groups, we have thematic groups as well as 1 steering group, the Charter for Change coordination groups, which steers the whole network. And these are all jointly managed, and membership as well within these D groups are both INGO members as well as local and national NGOs who come together either for Charter for Change advocacy and advocacy products or Charter for Change capacity strengthening discussions and how to take that forward. We also have other thematic groups such as the Charter for Change reporting group, which we activate when we have to produce our annual report or the annual meeting. We have a separate group for that. So it really allows us to, it provides us the flexibility to open groups based on requirement. Other than the groups we have online, we also have country level groups, which are being led by local organizations, frontline workers on ground, who are members of the network, who have created their own groups. They're still using the Charter for Change, the main list we have on D groups to collaborate with each other, to share their experiences, to reach out for support. So in terms of keeping in touch, exchanging information, and ensuring we have communication for more and to enable collaborative work, the D groups system has helped us to continue that work. In terms of what value our members get, the network itself is quite unique. It's within the humanitarian system. It's one of the only networks that has such a huge membership base of local NGO members, local and national NGO members, where generally and traditionally the localization discussion has been led by the UN or else actors in the global north, which at least to me is a very top-down, but the Charter for Change network allows us to bring together different members to do make progress more collaboratively and to hear from local actors on the localization discussion. The network itself has allowed for collaboration in everything we do, from our joint products to our annual meeting, to our online discussions, and taking that forward offline. That's one way that members get that value of staying connected and making progress, and within their own organization as well as externally. Other than that, we have because our so say for COVID, for example, which has pushed meetings online. So with the charter change, and because our members are in different countries all over the world, our meetings have been online throughout, and we do meet once a year physically. But again, most of our work has happened online, and we continue to do so. And that has enabled us to access more members, you know, regardless of whether a member has bandwidth issues or not. Anyone can join, anyone can. And again, membership is free and voluntary. So that has allowed us to increase our reach and bring together different actors to work together and also allow for wider participation amongst a diverse membership base. Another value that members have gotten is that it brings together different actors on an equal ground. So regardless of whether you're from an INGO member or a local organization, all members have this platform and different groups to participate actively on an equal footing, and it also has allowed us to engage in more cross-learning and hearing from local actors, local voices, to hear from them on what issues need to be put forward in global discussions, and ensuring that they are the ones who are leading the discussion and the messages we are putting forward. In terms of ease of use, like for me as a local actor, it has been, you know, without technical training, it's easy to manage the D groups and the various thematic groups that we have. Even for our local members, there is nothing much in terms of technical capacity that's required, regardless of that kind of, even in terms of the hardware we have, you can access it. It's, you know, as long as you're part of the mailing list, you're able to send, receive messages and communicate to all members in the group. Other than what we've been doing internally, the network has also, within the Charter for Change network, because we have members who are part of different networks as well, it's enabled us to reach members wider than our own network. So other humanitarian networks or advocacy networks have reached out to us, shared their information, their products, their events, and have you know, been able to reach our own membership base, and vice versa, we've also been able to reach other networks. Other than that, with endorsement members, again, since the unique part of the Charter for Change is that it brings together so many local actors in one place and allows them to collaboratively work with INGO members, it's become, this group has, from a handful of members, has grown out to more than 440 endorser members, and who have regular meetings. Every month we have a meeting with endorser members who lead the discussion, who share updates from their end. And it's become really a safe space for them to openly talk about the issues that they have been facing, the messages that they want to see being focused in the localization discussion, and how they are trying to, you know, ensure that their voices, the voices of those they serve, the affected communities, are those messages are coming forward in global discussions. So it's really allowed for endorser members to come together, and again, you know, without ever having met each other, members from different countries are able to work together, you know, on issues that they all commonly have been facing with within the humanitarian architecture. In terms of how we deliver value, so the Charter for Change network has been a unique platform within the sector. There are in terms of the other platforms that are available, those are mostly UN-led, or it's the Grand Bargain, which is more government, UN, INGO dominated. But within the Charter for Change network, again, because of it being voluntary, free, the cost is being borne by INGOs such as Oxfam right now for D groups. It's allowed us, you know, to bring all these different actors together to jointly work on making progress in localization. Other than that, information exchange has been, it's been easier to exchange information despite our geographical barriers, we've been able to, we have monthly meetings with all the different groups who have been able to share what's happening at their level, feedback from meetings, you know, in a transparent way, like I mentioned also, because it's a, generally most of these groups are close to members of the Charter for Change itself. So for, to, you know, to speak openly on the issues, that's another, and share your whatever information openly, transparently, without, you know, having to worry about maybe repercussions of critical voices. That I think has been another way that members have been able to actively engage. Other than that, we operate in a very principled way. So regardless of individual organization agendas, regardless of whether we are part of localization funded projects or not, all members have come together, you know, with a common purpose. And again, our members have been, we have been very passionate about localization. So most of that kind of passion has been channeled into our work. So regardless of our own agendas, we've been able to jointly work on products. And again, now recently we have we've been working on the Charter for Change annual report, an advocacy paper for the grand bargain, and again that has brought together inputs from different members within the organization. In terms of even the way we work and the change we want to see in the humanitarian architecture, we've been able to do that in a joint and more collaborative manner. So even at say high level advocacy events, we've been able to catalyze different members who are active in those platforms and different members who have say put forward their voices and what they want to see. They've been able to come together to produce those advocacy products as well as model the change within their own organizations. So for our INGO members especially, because it's part of their annual reporting and the progress, the commitments that they have signed to, they have been able to make change within their own organizations, which is reflected in our annual reports, as well as advocate for change externally. Yeah, and lastly, in terms of catalyzing the localization process, so because we've been able to have these discussions via email, via the D-Groups platform, and our regular virtual meetings, we've also been able to use that to take the discussion forward offline with the country level meetings or via mail exchanges. In all our products, try to ensure that it's consultative in nature, and our different members are able to provide their input on it, both at global level as well as country level. Other than that, I think I'm going to end here. Yeah, maybe if there are any questions that are part of this presentation, we can take it up.